Hi, my name is Natasha McDougald, and I'm the product manager for Cochlear Implants here in Cochlear Americas. Today, I have the pleasure of interviewing Marian Jones, all the way from Sydney. Marian, can you tell us what you do every day at Cochlear?
Thanks, Natasha. Well, I'm very fortunate to be a member of the clinical audiology team at Cochlear, who work very closely with product development project teams, where we provide input from a clinician and recipient perspective, as well as conduct clinical studies on pre-approved sound processors and accessories.
That's wonderful. What a great job. I know you're a key member of the Kanso 2 sound processor development team. Can you walk us through that process?
Cochlear has a well-defined product development process. For Kanso 2, this involved an initial phase of defining and selecting the processor concept, which included focus groups with recipients and market research conducted with clinicians, recipients, and candidates completed in 5 countries across Cochlear's 3 global regions. Early prototype builds were tested both on the bench by engineers and also used in clinical feasibility testing. Throughout the clinical trial, the study participants were fitted with different processor iterations as the features were developed or introduced. This phase is quite crucial to obtain real-world use of the processors in its various stages of development, as inevitably this experience highlights what may still need to be tweaked or modified. And this can be in both the physical hardware design as well as the firmware and software. An integral part of the product development process is usability engineering, and the FDA guidance on human factors, where the focus is on the interaction of the user with the processor and associated accessories. Early stage testing was conducted on the product prototypes to establish baseline user performance and satisfaction levels for future usability evaluations. Once the Kanso 2 processor design progressed, usability studies were conducted in parallel with the Kanso 2 clinical trial, so the usability of the product was validated with representative end users, that is recipients, carers, and clinicians.
That's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. One of the new features of the Kanso 2 sound processor is Autoon. Can you tell us a little bit more about that feature?
Certainly. So recipients have a diverse set of needs, but they all want their sound process to be easy and seamless to use. And the Autoon feature certainly does meet this desire. So whilst we have Autoon 3 and 7 by connecting the battery to the processor, the Autoon feature for Kanso 2 is activated by picking up the processor and placing it on the implant. The feature is facilitated due to the presence of an accelerometer, which detects movement of the sound processor. The sensitivity of the accelerometer has been finely tuned to ensure that the recipient experience is as simple as possible, whilst at the same time preserving battery life. With Autoon enabled by default, it means the clinicians can have confidence that the recipients will be hearing without the need for any interaction with the sound processor. And for children, this can also mean an increase in independence as they can easily place the processors on themselves. Overall, Kanso 2 allows the clinician to spend less time on processor instruction and focus on the care of the individual.
That is so great. It is such an innovative new feature and exciting to hear the kind of thought process that went behind it. Well, thank you so much for spending the time with us today and helping us to get an inside look at how sound processor development happens at Cochlear. Thank you and enjoy your day.
Thank you, Natasha.